I'm Trevor, and my main claim is that the death penalty is an ineffective punishment, and my three supporting claims are innocent people can be sentenced to death, all the appeals clog our courts, and taxpayers pay more for the death penalty. I'm going to tell you a little story about a man named Patrick Croy to show that innocent people can be sentenced to death. In 1978, after a weekend of partying that led to a shootout between police and a group of partiers, including Patrick Croy, he was detained and convicted in 1978 for the murder of police officer Beau Hitson during the shootout. He was not convicted directly of murder, but of intentional robbery that led to the officer's death. In 1985, his conviction and death sentence were overturned when the California Supreme Court found that the trial judge had read the instructions wrong to the jury, which allowed the jury to convict Croy of robbery even if he did not intend to steal. And this reversed the murder conviction because since he was found guilty of the murder conviction through his intent on robbery, since they overturned the robbery conviction, it reversed his murder conviction. And the case was retried in 1990, and he was acquitted on everything except for a conspiracy charge, and he was sentenced to 10 years of probation. And in 1997, he violated his probation and was given a life sentence, and he petitioned for a writ of habeas corpus, asking for the judgment of his 1979 trial to be vacated. On February 18, 2005, a judge adopted his writ of habeas corpus and overturned and vacated the conspiracy conviction. And he was released on March 20th, 2005. He spent 19 years in prison and 7 on death row for something he was not guilty of. So, from deathpenalty.org, the United States has a total of 138 exonerations like Patrick Croy since 1973, and 6 of which were in California. And it's important because innocent people are going to get executed if we leave the death penalty in effect. And AmnestyUSA.org says most factors leading to wrongful convictions include inadequate legal representation, police and prosecutorial misconduct, perjured testimony, and mistaken eyewitness testimony. My second supporting claim is that all of these appeals clog the courts. According to AmnestyUSA.org, trials in which the prosecutor is seeking a death sentence have 2 separate and distinct phases: conviction, when the defendant is proved guilty or innocent, and then sentencing. But during death penalty cases, they have to have special motions and extra time for jury selection so that they can balance out and make sure everything is legally sound. And my third supporting claim is that taxpayers pay more for the death penalty. Life in prison is cheaper than the death penalty. From criminal justice degree schools, on average, it costs $620,932 per trial in federal death cases, which is 8 times higher than when the death penalty isn't sought. Also, from criminal justice degree schools, if you include the appeals, incarceration times, and the execution in a death penalty case, the cost is close to $3 million per inmate, as opposed to just over $1 million if the death penalty isn't sought. And recent studies have also found that the higher the cost of legal counsel in a death penalty case, the less likely the defendant is to receive the death penalty. And on AmnestyUSA.org, I found that according to the California Commission for the Fair Administration of Justice, using conservative rough projections, the commission estimates the annual cost of the present system to be $137 million a year, and a system which imposes a maximum penalty of lifetime incarceration instead of the death penalty is $11.5 million, and that's just for the state of California, so it's $125 million extra dollars a year we're wasting on cases trying to give people the death penalty. And California has only had 11 executions spread over 27 years, and on a per execution basis, California and taxpayers have paid more than $250 million for each execution of a person. And on deathpenalty.org, it costs approximately $90,000 more a year to house an inmate on death row than an inmate in a life sentence in just a normal prison. And with California's current death row population of 670, that's $63 million for $63.3 million annually, and with the $125 million approximately earlier, about $188 million a year could be saved if we took the death penalty just out of California. So world or through outer nation, that would end up as a lot more money a year. And then AmnestyUSA.org says more, because when prosecutors are trying to take the death penalty to a person, they have to use more investigative costs to make sure that they're doing the right trial for the person, I guess, giving them the fair punishment. So they have to use a lot more money and resources to get all their info correct. And when death penalty trials result in a verdict less than death or are reversed, taxpayers first incur all the extra costs of capital pretrial and trial proceedings, and they must also pay either for the cost of incarcerating the prisoner for life or the cost of a retrial. So when a death penalty either gets turned into life incarceration or they have to do a retrial, we have to pay for the first trial, and then there's second trials or life in prison anyway. So if we just took death penalty off and gave them life in prison, we wouldn't have to go through all those extra steps that are clogging the court. And that is why innocent people can be sentenced to death. All the appeals clog our courts, and taxpayers pay more for the death penalty. And that is why the death penalty is an ineffective punishment.
All right, thank you all for your patience here. Let me get through this very quickly. You do clearly state your claim. There's a good setup of the secondary points. Your first point, you only got the one example that you're talking about. You've got a follow-up statistic on it, but I'm not exactly sure that that really deals with the issue of innocence. I think it's got more to do with some legal procedure. So there's some questions about that argument. The second point that you've got is really underdeveloped. You've got basically got some general information on that point. The third point is where all of your data is, and I'm not, you know, I'm kind of surprised that that's just not the whole point of your argument. Get rid of the first two things and just talk about the cost issues, because you've got a lot of data on that particular point. You need to look up a little bit more while you're talking to the audience and be a bit more forceful. Thank you all for your patience tonight. All right.